into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher. Water you turned into
when you come in, just take your time. You'll be directed as to where you can sit. It may not be your regular seat. If it's open, that's fine. But we'll have seating on our entrance on the outside aisle for those who are, as you enter, on the left, and entrance on the center aisle on the right. So just make sure that, just take your time, be patient. We're re-entering the place. We are, Tammy and Wayne and Sean and Melanie have done a tremendous amount of work through these weeks that everybody's been absent about getting things in shape for inside. So I deeply appreciate all that they've done. We've got something else going on today. We talked about feeding the homeless. One of the things that we're looking at now, how can we do outreach during a time like this when we can't touch things with each other? Well, one of the things that we felt that we could do was provide food for the homeless. The homeless don't have a home to shelter in. They didn't before this. The homeless don't always get something to eat. St. Mark's Community Church, Community Center in New Orleans, has been feeding on a regular basis. And so our church is providing the food for them today. So that you're making a difference. It's being delivered by one of the members of our church today. They will have people who are trained in this and who will hand out the food to those who are hungry. So thank you for those who contributed to this. We appreciate that so much. So once again, I'll mention the online survey. We're also looking at, if we only have a few in there, we'll still just have one service. But if we're looking at having a lot of people come back inside, then we've got to go to two, and it would be 8:30 and 10:30. And so on that survey, it indicates whether what your choice would be in that, whether it's be an 8:30 or 10:30 service. Online attendance registration. As you know, we're not going to be passing if we're passing the pads around, then you're germs from other people. You know, those germy people. I feel like I'm in elementary school again. You know, they got, you're chasing around each other through the playground. Well, so we attend registration online. And so there's a link. Go to the website, which is newlifeluling.com. I was confused about it when I made my announcement, but it's newlifeluling.com. Attendance, and if you'll do that, if you enjoy this sermon so much you want to watch it again, you're welcome to on YouTube. And for those who are watching online, maybe you get distracted or pulled aside somewhere, and you're not able to take the time to watch right now. You can watch it later on; it'll be on YouTube as well. So I'm looking at that. One last thing. I had asked about people to write down just a few words about a witness about how God has been active in their lives. And some have shared their whole testimony. Others have shared something recently. This coming week, I'm going to be putting that together. If you haven't sent it in yet, you got to do it this week, because the next week, when Rebecca gets back from vacation, we'll be looking at how we're going to print that up or how we're going to send that out to you, so that you'll get to read about some of the stories of what God has been doing in other people's lives. And like I said, it could be a healing that you've gone through. It could be a time when you thought everything was at a loss and the Lord came through for you. Just write a few words. It'll make a difference in someone else's life. All right. I'm looking at the announcements and so forth. I'm not going to have y'all stand up because it's hard to get out of those chairs. I understand that. So we'll just go to our opening song. So join with me, if you will. to the Lord in the spirit of prayer. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given. We've had rain. We didn't know whether we'd be able to meet together outdoors. But in the beauty of your sanctuary outside, the canopy that covers us, Lord, that we are in a holy place. So this is holy ground that we're on now. And we praise you, Lord, as you are the God of all, that you love us deeply. For those who are here today, for those who are back home or other places spread, possibly all over the world, Lord, we just give you praise and thanks for your faithfulness in our time of desperation. Because this has been such a difficult time, Lord. So we give you praise as we open our hearts to you in worship. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'll join with me in the Apostles' Creed, it is a historic profession of the Christian faith. And so we keep that profession of faith, no matter whether we're gathered in a sanctuary or under trees, that God is faithful. Join with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Psalms, we often go there for comfort and strength. And this psalm is a song of sadness at the beginning. But if you'll look in the Psalms, you'll see a pattern that's there. And the pattern through most of the Psalms, I think there's only one that doesn't follow the pattern. That if it's either just outright praise to God, or it's saying at the end, after the psalmist voices their complaint, at the end, it's always a positive statement of God's faithfulness. This is Psalm 13. It's one that some maybe have felt like they're going through this during this time. Thank you. make along the way. So at this time, let's go to the Lord in a spirit of prayer. And for others that you may know of that are going through a tough time during this time of the quarantine, for some it's easier than others. For some who have kids and having to have been teachers and parents as well, has been a tough run. But I've seen so much creativity that people have had in taking care of their kids. Let's be thinking about others who may need your prayers. And at this point, let's begin our time of prayer. And then if you'll say aloud the name of the person or persons that you would like for us to remember as the body of Christ this morning. Others who are online will be perhaps writing those out, or you can say them aloud. And so let's continue. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you with hearts that bear the weight of the hurt of others. And so, Lord, we pray that you would minister to those that we mention by name now. Lord, you're faithful and good. And so, Lord, we know that you hear their names and you see their faces. And you're already ministering to them. Heavenly Father, in the beginning, when you created the first human, you breathed your spirit, your breath of life into us. Breath is the very essence of life in you. And when we cry out, I can't breathe, something is wrong. We've heard that cry from those struggling with the COVID-19 disease. Every breath, some need a respirator to help them breathe. We pray that you'll restore their breath and heal those who are suffering from this deadly virus. Give them life again. Keep others of us safe as we still face the effects of this pandemic. And yet we're in a second pandemic as well. It's been going on for a long time. When we hear the words again, I can't breathe, as a police officer abuses his position with his knee on the neck of a black man who cries out for another breath, we wonder, was it prejudice towards the man because he was black? Possibly. Was it because of something personal that they had between them? Possibly they knew each other. So now, because of the lack of compassion of this officer, as well as the officers who stood by and did nothing, even in the heat of the moment, George Floyd is dead. Every honest and fair police officer is then judged because of one officer's cruel actions. Many people, black and white, feel they're in danger and look at one another with suspicion. Racial strife and hatred rises. Violence begets violence. That is not the way of the kingdom of God, but that seems to be the way of the kingdom of this world. And so the overwhelming sense of injustice and prejudice against those who are different from us takes our breath away, and we're overwhelmed. We can't breathe. And so we ask, O Lord, to send your healing breath of the Holy Spirit. Once again, send us, as in that first Pentecost, send us your breath so that we might breathe again, to bring us to life, to heal us from our prejudices that cause us to look down on others, to heal us from our hatred, to bring justice for all, to protect our law officers whose hearts are true and wish to serve and protect all members of their community. Bring the breath of your Holy Spirit so that we can all breathe again. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who came into this world as a Jew and emerged as the Savior of all, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So if you have your Bibles with you, you can follow along with me. It's in 1 Kings, which means that if you just have the New Testament, you're looking around for it. It's in 1 Kings chapter 8. And this is a passage of when the temple of Solomon, the first temple, was built, and Solomon was praying for the people. So hear the word of God as we are looking at 1 Kings 8, 56 through 61. As soon as Solomon finished praying and making these requests to the Lord, he got up from before the Lord's altar where he had been kneeling with his hands spread out to heaven. And he stood up and blessed the whole Israelite assembly in a loud voice. May the Lord be blessed. He's given rest to his people Israel, just as he promised. He hasn't neglected any part of the good promise that he made through his servant Moses. May the Lord our God be with us, just as he was with our ancestors. May he never leave us or abandon us. May he draw our hearts to him to walk in all his ways and observe his commandments, his laws, and his judgments that he gave our ancestors. And may these words of mine that I have cried out before the Lord remain near to the Lord our God day and night, so that he may do right by his servant and his people Israel for each day's need. And so that all the peoples, earth's peoples, may know that the Lord is God, and there is no other God. Now may you be committed to the Lord your God with all your heart by following his laws and observing his commands, just as you're doing right now. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Lord, we praise you as we are gathered outside of this sanctuary. It's been a very precious place for so many of us. Many wonderful memories. But Lord, it's not about our memories, and it's not really about us. It's about you. This is your house. And so, Lord, we offer ourselves to you as we prepare to enter next week into this sanctuary once again, that you might make it a place that is holy and set apart for us, and that we might be a people that's holy and set apart for you. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Now, I've got to fix my paper a little bit because they're flying everywhere. As long as I took care of that one. Well, Ron and I don't know. I don't think it was during the pandemic time and the quarantine time, but I think it may have been before this. We still bought some new lamps for our living room. And they are kind of contemporary, modern lamps, and they're reading lamps, so they have a stand on it. And it's for each side of the sofa, because we're on each side of the sofa, because that's where the remote control is to lift our feet, right? So there's a lamp on each side, and it has a stand to it, and it has that contemporary look. And they have these little round tables on them, so that's, you know, we can place our coffee there, and enjoy reading or spending time on our laptops. But they have something a little bit different that's on that round stand. In the center of it, there is this round circle that's lighted up, that's sitting on in the middle of that stand, and it's lighted up. It happens to be red. It could be any color. But it's lighted up, and, you know, at first you're looking at it going, what is that? And it also has on that stand this little slot that maybe a computer into that slot. And so that's actually a USB port. Do y'all know what those are for? Huh? Yeah, okay. That's right. They're used to recharge your phone. So the little lighted circle, when I lay my phone on the lighted circle, my phone lights up and it starts charging my phone. If that doesn't work right, which happens sometimes, you know, I've got the plug here and that I'll plug the other end into the USB port. And so my phone gets charged, it gets power. And basically the lamps are not only to provide light, but they are charging stations. Now, every cell phone that I've ever heard of needs to be recharged. And it's going to be recharged eventually, or else the phone is just a useless piece of plastic and metal. And we lose, I can't remember Rhonda's number without my phone having it come up. All the other telephone numbers seem to disappear. And now that my phone's not charged and it's not working right, it's gone. It's useless to me. If I don't use the recharge station, whether it's a lamp or a plug it in at the house or the airport or wherever, you know, I lose all my pictures, I lose my telephone numbers. If I don't intentionally all those plugs are useless to me. So church is like a recharge station. The power of God's Spirit flows through it. Now, I've heard a lot of people say that they go to church in order to... Okay. Which way do I need to move the microphone? Right. Can you hear me now? All right, let's try that. That's right. Well, that's the nature. When we change everything around, it's really hard to get it. Also, when your microphone isn't talking to the receiver, you don't have any power either. So you find yourself kind of at a loss. We are intentionally using and making those connections that we need to make. Church, like this recharge station, the power of God flows through it. And I've heard people talking about how that they do go to church to get their batteries recharged. But, you know, we all know that the church is not a building. You know, that may be one way of looking at it, because the church has never been closed. The church has only left the building, and you've heard that before, and just for a little while. The word church comes from the Greek word ekklesia, and that means those who are called out, the called out ones. And it also has another meaning of an assembly of those who share a common belief. So you've got these two meanings to this word, the church, the called out ones who gather together for worship. And so the building is just like an ark. It's a box. It holds the church. And as the church, we have managed to stay connected one way or another through long distance connections as best we could, online streaming. People give their greetings to one another online. There are phone calls we can still do. There are emails, snail mail. There is drive-by parades. There's all kinds of things that we have done. But there is something about a place where we can gather together as the church, a place that is consecrated to God, where we can get our batteries recharged and be the church the rest of the week. A church building is a witness to the rest of the community. This church building, even being here, we've had people who came here looking for help. Some of it's spiritual help, not just food or paying bills, but some of it's spiritual help because they knew that God was present in this place, and this is where they could find him. Come here to this place. So a church building is a witness to the community. It's a place where people feel they can find God. Well, in the book of Exodus, God commanded Moses to build a tabernacle. They hadn't had anything like this before. There was nothing like this before with Abraham or even prior to this. But now God commanded Moses to build a tabernacle, and it was to be a place of worship where God's presence could be experienced. And so it was a portable building. It was a tent. because the Israelites were on the move. They had to move all the time, so they moved their building everywhere they went. They moved the tent of worship. And when Moses would enter into it, there would be a cloud that would come, and it would come and it would gather there at the tent. And also at other times, the cloud would enter inside of the tent itself, the tabernacle, the place where God dwelt. This cloud is called the Shekinah glory. The cloud would glow with just this inner presence of God. And that would be the presence of God in this place, the Shekinah glory of God. It signified the glorious presence of the living God. Now, King David wanted to build a permanent temple. But God wouldn't allow him to. And so later, when David's son, Solomon, was made king, Solomon was able to fulfill the dream of his father, able to build the temple. It was a massive stone building. It was considered to be one of the wonders of the ancient world. It was adorned with gold and metals. So the great temple of Jerusalem was this great and mighty building. And before they entered the temple, when they were dedicating it, they had a time of worship and celebration. In our text in 1 Kings, it speaks of the great celebration before the people entered its courts. And the priest brought the Ark of the Covenant in. And it says this in verses 10 and 11 of chapter 8 of 1 Kings. When the priest withdrew from the holy place, the cloud filled the temple of the Lord. And the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled his temple. The glory of the presence of God, the Shekinah glory of God, filled the temple. And during this great celebration, in preparation of others entering the temple, the parts that they could enter, King Solomon prayed that blessing over the whole community. And that we read just a little while ago. It was a blessing that recognizing God's faithfulness. And it was also recognizing the fact that they needed to keep their commitment to the Lord, that there is this covenant between God and themselves. Well, during the times of King Jesus, King Herod rebuilt, remodeled the great temple that was there when Jesus walked the earth. And they say that it took them 46 years to build it, and it still wasn't finished. In 1 John, in fact, chapter 2, this is early in his ministry. Jesus said, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." And they replied, "It's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body, the scripture says, which happened at his resurrection. The temple was destroyed at the crucifixion, but it was raised up again in 3 days on the resurrection. And before Jesus ascended to heaven, 40 days after his resurrection, his last instruction to his disciples was found in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 5. "Wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." There he is there. Didn't sound like a train, but it sounded like the roaring of a mighty wind. And so then in Acts chapter 2, the Bible talks about how they were there together in one place. And there began a wind there inside that place, swirling around. Fire and wind, the fire seeming to settle on the heads of each of them. And they began to speak in other languages, God enabled them, as the Spirit enabled them. And they were charged up, and they were energized with the Holy Spirit because of the presence of the Lord had now come to dwell within them. Now, they were the temple of God. And that within every believer is the temple of God, and that's where the Spirit of God dwells. When the Holy Spirit came, their batteries weren't just recharged, their batteries were supercharged. And then they left the upper room where they had been gathered. They didn't stay there and just dance around for a while and talking to each other. They left the building. And then they went out to the steps where other people were. And they began to proclaim the good news of forgiveness of sins and salvation through the resurrection, through the resurrected Jesus Christ. And they changed the world. Now today, this is Pentecost Sunday. We are not at Eastertide anymore. We are now, this begins the Pentecost season. This is when we celebrate that first coming of the Holy Spirit, but he didn't come and just disappear. He didn't ascend up. He came to stay and to live within the lives and hearts of believers, of those who place their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And his Shekinah glory fills us as the church, because we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. And we come to recharge our batteries, to find strength in one another. We find strength in the presence of the living God. We find strength in Jesus Christ, whom we worship. And that happens when we assemble together, because we feel like there are others. I'm not in this alone. There are others that I can see and that I can talk to and that I can connect with as best I can in these days. And so as we prepare next week to re-enter into our sanctuary, we have been in a time of exile. We feel that. And we'll need to re-enter with prayer. Please be praying this week as we do that. We want to do it in the safest ways possible. But as we re-enter into the building, we re-enter it with prayer. Our world has been experiencing this. It's a demonic plague. This isn't anything that God sent. This is a demonic thing. It's killed over 100,000 people just in the United States. And in the rest of the world, it's killed over 360,000 people. And that's only counting those that we know of died of the disease and that could be accounted for and registered. We don't really know about what unconfirmed deaths there may be out there, because the coronavirus is still with us. It hasn't gone anywhere. We have separated so that it doesn't have anywhere to go, but we still don't have a vaccine. We still have to take every precaution to protect and care for one another. To follow the strict guidelines that we have. I don't know if you've ever washed your hands so much in your life or sanitized your hands so much as we're doing now, or maintaining social distancing. We're becoming much more aware of how close we are, wearing face masks, limiting our exposure to others. So we carefully return to worship together as the people of God. But remember, the purpose of the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost was not just to make the apostles feel good and recharge. They immediately left the upper room, and they went out into the whole world to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so when we gather as the church to worship, no matter where or when it is or what building we're in, we experience the glory of God, to be filled with the Spirit, but we don't stay at the recharging station. We don't stay at the recharging station. If you keep your cell phone plugged in, it kind of defeats the purpose of being a cell phone anymore. You got to unplug the thing, and then it becomes a mobile phone. We come to worship and get our spiritual batteries recharged, not just to stay plugged into this place, but to go out and to be used by God, recharged so that we go out and expend, and we're being made use of in the way that we were intended, as God intended for us to be. And so we go out and be used by God. When God's people go into the building consecrated to God, the church enters the building. After worship, the church has left the building. So how do we minister in a world where everything is changed? The Holy Spirit is going to show you new ways. If you have the Spirit of God within you, he's going to reveal things to you. He is for a reason. He's empowered you for your purpose that he has for you. And so he's going to inspire each person to different ministries that will help others and that will touch the lives of others for Jesus Christ. It's going to fit your personality. It's going to be just exactly what you need in a new way to minister to others. Just know that in this time, what do we do when we go back out into the world? We pray, because we're keeping the connection, even if it's a mobile connection with our Heavenly Father. We pray. We listen. We take ownership of what God calls us to do. So sometimes people call me up, you know what the church needs to do? No, that's what you need to do. God talked to you about this, so he must be, his intent must be for you to go out. Because he powered you up, didn't you? He recharged your battery, didn't he? So it's for that purpose of going out into the world. So we take ownership of what God is calling us to do. We recruit others with a similar calling or maybe who don't know what to do yet. We act. God will inspire you with ideas for ministry. We're already starting to see it happen with Vacation Bible School. We're looking at an online kind of Vacation Bible School, which who would have thought we'd have to ever do something like that? Packets maybe for the kids to pick up and work on at home with their families. There are other things that we can still do. We can still minister to the homeless as we have this morning. So he'll inspire us. And those he inspires, he equips and he empowers. So as we prepare to re-enter our sanctuary for in-person worship or to continue to worship online, we pray that the Lord will fill this place with his glory, with his Holy Spirit glory, his Shekinah glory, his living presence, and not just the building, but us, to get recharged, and that we go out and be the church to a hurting and dying world that's deeply in need of good news today. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Lord, we love you. We praise you. We pray, Lord, that that we emphasize things in the right way, that we emphasize our need for you more than anything else, and for your Holy Spirit to fill us with new life so that we will minister to others. It's not about us. It's all about you. So thank you, Lord, for these moments. We offer ourselves up to you in the name of Jesus, our Lord. As we have done online, we do now, that is take our time for our offering. We do have a bowl up here. We're trying to keep things from flying away as possible. But if you're giving online, please continue to do that by all means. I think that works out the best for everyone. But we want to ourselves, something of ourselves to the Lord. So in moments, let's bow our heads as we offer up ourselves to him. You're welcome to come up and place something in the plate. Our Heavenly Father, we praise you for what you've given, for your faithful and loving God. So we ask, Lord, that you would receive these, our gifts, our tithes, our offerings that we give to you in these moments and in the moments ahead. Let it be an act of worship. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a blessing called the Aaronic blessing, not ironic, but the Aaronic, as in Aaron, the brother of Moses who became the first high priest. And we've said it at different times in our saying goodbye to each other and asking God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face upon you and give you peace. The song is that, and we encourage you to, if you are able, to learn it and to sing it out. And let it be our time of benediction as well. The Lord bless you. May
make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Join with me if you can.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
One more time, sing with us.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Promises that come with this blessing as well. Promises of the scripture.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May the presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going and your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Benediction. Turn that off. Hear the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Lord, turn his face upon you and give you peace. Amen. God bless y'all. Thank y'all for coming out today. Remember, next week we'll be going inside the sanctuary. Be in prayer about that as we prepare for that. We want to do it in the safest way possible. So it's good to see some of your faces and others. I'm seeing you the way that I've seen you the past few weeks, right through the camera. But glad that you joined us today. So God bless you all.